Tonight, we'll tell you how Israel is reacting to the latest proposals for a Middle East peace conference.
You'll also meet Abe Foxman of the ADL, who has some questions about Supreme Court nominee Clarence Thomas.
And I'm Melody Gilbert, and I'll have a report about how some of New York's elderly Jews are about to lose their only hot meal of the day.
Plus, a movie review about a young Jewish boy who became a Nazi. This and more tonight on the JNN Evening News.
I'm Nicole Adler.
And I'm Howard Barbanel, and here's what's happening. In a surprise diplomatic move this week, Syria announced that it accepts the U.S. formula for convening a Middle East peace conference. In a confidential letter to President Bush from Syrian President Hafez Assad, the Syrians accepted a formula whereby the U.N. would enjoy observer status at an opening conference, and that a conference would be held under the sponsorship of the five permanent members of the U.N. Security Council. In London, President Bush termed Assad's letter as being very positive, but that it needs further study. The Syrian acceptance of U.S. terms stole some of the thunder at the G7 economic conference and caught Israeli leaders by surprise. The Israelis passed on the Bush plan, preferring a formula whereby an opening conference would be sponsored by the U.S. and the Soviets, with European observers, and with no role whatsoever for the U.N. Jerusalem has cautiously welcomed the reportedly forthcoming letter from Assad. Israel can back down from its opposition to a UN role in the conference, or it can stand its ground and risk being portrayed as blocking the peace process. To further the momentum, Secretary of State Baker is headed back to the Middle East this weekend and plans to stop in Israel on Sunday after the Tisha B'Av holiday. Baker is hopeful for positive results from his latest trip. Israeli leaders expect to come under heavy pressure to come around to the U.S. point of view. Baker's feelings were expressed at a London press conference.
The seven made clear that they attach overriding importance to launching a process designed to bring comprehensive, just, and lasting peace and reconciliation between Israel, the Arab states, and the Palestinians. The declaration supports the concept of a peace conference starting parallel and direct negotiations between Israel and representative Palestinians on the one hand and Israel and the Arab states on the other. And our G7 partners have confirmed their continuing support for our current initiative to advance the peace process, which we collectively believe offers the best hope of progress towards a settlement.
While the Syrians are sending out peace letters, Israeli Foreign Minister David Levy charges that Syria is implementing a radical policy of massive military deployment by stockpiling advanced missiles and chemical weapons. Levy said that Israeli caution vis-a-vis Syria is a result of their track record and their close proximity to Israel. Levy further charged that Syria has used the several billion dollars it received from the U.S. and the Gulf states during the Gulf War to acquire advanced Scud missiles from North Korea and Communist China. Syria's diplomatic bombshell left Israelis mixed in their opinions as to Israel's position and reaction to this possible peace initiative. We have more in this report from Michael McMillan in Jerusalem.
The Golan Heights and Israel's border with Syria, land taken by the Jewish state in 1967, and only a few days ago, this display of strength designed not to woo the Syrians to the negotiating table, but to show them that it's territory which is unlikely to be relinquished willingly. In Jerusalem today, where jobless Soviet immigrants take to the streets to busk, Syria's apparent willingness to talk brings about a political isolation the Israelis don't need. What they do need is $10 billion from America to settle an influx so far of some 300,000 people. There's potential for American pressure, but as always here, reaction to Arab overtures are mixed.
That's excellent. I mean, now let's wait and hear what will be Israel's reaction. I mean, I living here, I don't feel that Israel's any more or less isolated than it ever was. And if it is, that's just reality that we have to live with.
The U.S. Secretary of State, Mr. Baker, has been curdling favor with President Assad since America needed his support in the Gulf War. Now, with promises of billions of dollars of investment, Syria is bending like never before. They have apparently compromised over Mr. Shamir's insistence that a peace conference must not be a reconvenable affair and that UN participation would only be at observer level. But will it be enough?
It was difficult for us here in Israel to see the UN as an objective observer that can serve as an intermediary or create a forum in which peace could be arrived at between Israel and the Arabs.
This astute Syrian move was not anticipated here, and already the Israeli Foreign Ministry and the Prime Minister's office are divided over reaction to it. But all of that's largely academic. This Israeli government will not negotiate land for peace, and much will depend on how far Mr. Baker is willing to go to pressurizing them into compromise. Michael Macmillan, BBC News in Jerusalem.
American Jewish leaders have reacted with a mix of hope and skepticism to the Syrian move. Shoshana Carden, chairperson of the President's Conference, said Syria's continuing purchase of sophisticated weapons and its denial of human rights to Syrian Jews are hardly the acts of a nation purporting to seek peace. Syria is currently keeping over 4,000 Syrian Jews virtual prisoners and subject to terrible persecution. Robert Lifton, president of the American Jewish Congress, said Syria's history of unremitting hostility to Israel fully justifies Israel's skepticism. The Simon Wiesenthal Center in Los Angeles urged Israel to accept a passive UN role in a peace conference if movement is made to repeal the 1975 Zionism is Racism resolution. The repeal should start with the Security Council, so talks could be jump-started, said Rabbi Marvin Heyer, the center's dean.
A 65-year-old new immigrant from France was attacked with an axe yesterday in downtown Netanya. She was attacked by an Israeli Arab from a nearby village and is hospitalized now in critical condition. Two other Israelis suffered minor wounds in the attack. The attacker was chased by bystanders and was then captured and turned over to the police. He admitted to the crime, but didn't give any reason for his actions. Nicole?
When we come back, you'll meet some senior citizens who are upset that they'll no longer be getting their free kosher meals, victims of budget cuts. And we'll tell you about an Israeli invention that could change the way you drive your car. Stay with us.
I am Yoav, a tour guide in Israel. To earn my license, I had to be able to answer questions about history, archaeology, and much else. It's funny, my Americans ask me as many questions about me as they do about Israel. They must feel very comfortable with me.
The Empire Restaurant, the most trusted name in kosher cuisine for 50 years. We serve naturally fresh-grown poultry. Roast, barbecued, and fried chicken, sandwiches, and a large variety of side orders and desserts. Lunch and dinner menus for the entire family. Come enjoy our fabulous kosher food in one of our two locations. We deliver. Call 718-997-7315 or 212-721-2508.
I love to read the Jerusalem Post magazine. I lived in Israel, and the magazine keeps me in touch with everyday life, trends, and issues facing every Israeli. It makes me feel like I'm home again.
I explore Israel in the pages of the Post. I love to read about Israel's culture and arts, its festivals and entertainment, its unique points of interest and events.
The Jerusalem Post takes me inside Israel's political and security issues. American papers devote limited editorial space to news I consider important, but the Post delivers the complete story.
Call the Jerusalem Post to receive three exciting issues free. You will receive an additional 26 issues, a total of 29 issues for only $19.97. So call toll-free, 1-800-955-8559. That's 1-800-955-8559 to receive your free issues.
We go now to Melody Gilbert at our local news desk. Melody, I understand that you've got a very touching story here.
Well, Howard, in New York City, Mayor Dinkins' budget axe has fallen, and among the hardest hit are 200,000 of New York's elderly Jews.
Like they have every day for the past 4 years, 83-year-old Dina Noth and 82-year-old Hannah Lishner walk arm in arm to this Upper West Side Senior Center to eat a free kosher lunch. Both say they just don't know what they'll do if city budget cuts force the center to stop serving meals.
We completely lost, not what I'm being lost, though my husband too. I'm not able to cook. I'm my vision are impaired, and my husband's affected with the Alzheimer. I couldn't cook. I can't, how would I be able to feed him? I can't see the water in the pot. So I need this place. It is very, very important to us.
For me, the worst thing was not to have anybody to share my meals. So since that time, I really have found a second home here. It is so important for us because this is the only center, a kosher center in Midtown Manhattan.
They are just two of thousands of New York's elderly, many of them Jewish, who are being hardest hit by New York's multi-million dollar cut in health and social services. By next year, more than 6,000 people who ask the Jewish Association for Services for the Aged for help won't be able to get it. Molly Seif has been coming to this 68th Street Center for 9 years.
There's nothing like eating to give you a community feeling. Breaking bread is a wonderful thing. So if we're deprived of that, we're deprived of something that's very special in our lives and really important because most of us live alone.
It's not just the people who come to senior citizen centers like this one who will be affected by the budget acts. Homebound elderly will also no longer be receiving home-delivered meals. More than a quarter of a million less meals will be delivered next year. For many, it's their only meal of the day. All in all, it's a problem these Jewish leaders say is a difficult one to solve.
It's a crisis unprecedented at the time that the Jewish community and its aged has its greatest need.
We'll lose the services that they've become accustomed to depend on, number one, which could mean that more people who won't be able to come to senior centers will end up staying in their homes more. It could promote more need for more costly institutionalization, homelessness possibly. A lot of these services help keep people in their homes.
It's more than food to most of these people that do come here. It's a social interaction. And the classes that they give them some self-esteem, because when you live alone, you tend to denigrate yourself in your own mind. And if they can't come here, they have nothing to look forward to.
A group called Alter Budget is proposing this solution.
Doing a better job of collecting the fines and fees that are owed the city, of which there are $4 billion outstanding at this time. Also, doing a better job administering programs in the city, more productivity, including productivity in the police department, in this new Safe Streets program, and including a fair and progressive tax structure.
Others say another way to pick up the slack is for Jews to donate more money directly to Jewish charities, so programs like this one will survive. Until then, it's people like Nachman Leventhal, whose wife passed away from Alzheimer's disease, who will suffer.
When I discovered this place about 4 years ago, I started coming, I come to life again. I came to life again.
With me now in the studio is David Sachs, president of UJA Federation of New York. Mr. Sachs, thank you so much for being with us. You know, these programs, like the one we just saw, are partially funded by UJA as well. Can you tell me why there's not enough money to go around anymore?
Yes, we only partially fund these programs. The balance of the funding comes principally from governmental sources, city and state, and some user fees. They're relatively modest. With an organization like JASA, for example, we fund them at a level of about $2.7 million a year. Without that $2.7 million, none of those programs would be held. The city and state monies are indeed important, but when we talk about budget cuts, $2 billion doesn't mean very much. Closing a senior citizen center brings it home to all of us.
So where is the money going now?
Well, the money is there. We cut our agencies this year by an average of 11.2%. JASA, in fact, was cut minimally. Services to the aged were cut minimally. Hospitals, we cut a great deal. We cut agencies which we felt were best able to take the blow such as hospitals and such as affluent agencies. But we've reorganized our priorities, and because of the emigration of Soviet and Ethiopian Jews to Israel and the emigration of Soviet Jews to the United States, we have put that at the very top of our priority list, and we have to meet those needs.
Tell me about some of the programs that you're funding now.
Well, the Soviet immigration started the United States in 1989, and we've been getting about 45% of all Soviet Jewish immigrants to the United States in the New York service area, which is just the city and the three suburban counties of Nassau, Westchester, and Suffolk. And that means we've been getting each year somewhere around 18,000 to 20,000 Soviet Jews coming to the New York metropolitan area. Last year, last government fiscal year, 20% of those got no government assistance whatsoever.
So they really depend on UJA.
They depend entirely on Jewish private philanthropy.
I was just going to ask you, when you say that, it's interesting. I was talking to you before about what percentage of the Jewish population actually contributes to these programs and to UJA.
Well, we get about 115,000 gifts a year out of a Jewish population and somewhat in excess of 1.5 million in the service area. If you assume there are three people in a family, we're not a very prolific group of people at the moment, and we are a very elderly group of people, Melody. That would be 500,000 families. If we get 115,000 gifts, that means that fewer than one out of every four of the Jewish families in New York is contributing. Even if we take the people living at or below the poverty level, we're probably getting gifts from about one out of every three Jewish families which can afford to give us gifts.
And that's not enough.
And I don't think they're fulfilling their age-old obligation of tzedakah.
Okay, so how do you change that?
Well, we do everything in our power. When I became president, we were getting 95,000 gifts. So the news is good. And in addition to Soviet Jews coming to the United States, we are helping with the resettlement of Soviet Jews, truly an exodus of Soviet Jews from the Soviet Union to Israel. The number is about 300,000 since January 1, 1990.
That's an incredible number. Hopefully more American Jews will support UJA Federation's efforts in the future. David Sachs, thank you so much for being with us today.
Thank you for having me, and with your help, more American Jews will support us.
Hopefully. Howard?
Thanks, Melody. Well, up next, a report about some Israeli inventions that could revolutionize how we use our cars and electrical appliances. Stay with us.
It's not a dream. Eldan, Israel's largest car rental company, with rentals starting from $182 per week. For reservations and information, call 1-800-533-8778. That's 1-800-533-8778. Eldan, try us first. Call 1-800-533-8778.
I knew about Rachel even before I met her. She wrote me letters from America. She was always so funny. Then one year, her family came to Israel, and it was like we'd known each other forever. Rachel and I, we agree on just about everything.
Tonight's business report is brought to you by the Star Trade Fund and by the Israel Commercial Economic Newsletter, ICEN, Israel's Business Weekly. For more information, call toll-free 1-800-456-5054.
Some corporations would throw Israel to the wolves for a profit. I'm Tom Sarkany, president of Star Trade Fund. We only invest in U.S.-traded corporations that do not participate in the Arab League's boycott of Israel. Now that the wolf is at Israel's door, ask yourself, am I inadvertently participating in this boycott through my money market or mutual fund?
Call now for a prospectus and read it carefully before you invest. 1-800-221-STAR. That's 1-800-221-STAR.
What's happening in the world of business? We go now to our business desk and our business correspondent, David Bash. David?
Well, Howard, let's take a look at how the markets are doing. The Dow Jones Industrial Average closed at 2,983.90 after reaching a high of 3,012.52. The Dow is down 6.91 from yesterday's close. NASDAQ over-the-counter stocks were down 2.59, closing at 493.6. And over at the American Stock Exchange, Amex issues were only down 0.25, closing at 365.53. On to the Tel Aviv Stock Exchange. According to the ICEN, the Tel Aviv Exchange variable list closed at 370.60, down 2.23. Yesterday's trading. ICEN reports signs of growth in the Israeli economy, and most significantly, news of a major oil and gas discovery has pushed the Tel Aviv Exchange to the near 400 mark. Investor confidence is being described as high. Nafta Petroleum reported hitting oil in a Negev well that has reserves of over 350,000 barrels, worth over $8 million at current world prices. Also from ICEN, Motorola is recruiting 100 new engineers to augment its staff of 1,600 in Tel Aviv. El Al reported its fifth straight year of profits for the recently closed fiscal year. El Al posted 14.1 million profit, this in spite of significant increases in cost of aviation fuel and the Gulf War. El Al management attributes this to the massive inflow of Soviet and Ethiopian immigrants, and that most major airlines stopped flying into Israel before and during the Gulf War. On the innovation front, Tadiran Electric's battery division has developed a unique lithium battery with a 20-year lifespan. Current lithium batteries have a 2-year life. The new battery is described as being very lightweight and able to operate in extreme temperatures. Israel is discovering oil, inventing long-lasting batteries, and now one Israeli company is seeking to break the world's dependence on fossil fuels. Luz is a company that now produces 92% of the world's solar energy. The name Luz came from Genesis, as the location where Jacob dreamt about the ladder that connected heaven and earth. So Luz is trying to connect the solar energy from heaven to save the earth from the devastating energy dependency on Mideast oil and nuclear waste byproducts. Luz Electric of Israel is developing a quick recharge battery that uses a syrupy zinc compound which mixes with oxygen in the air to produce electricity. This battery can be almost instantly recharged in just 5 minutes at a battery filling station by replacing the zinc liquid with a freshly charged dose. This is in marked contrast to most previous electric car batteries, which must be recharged overnight. The new battery will be road tested next year in a 385-mile run between Sacramento and Los Angeles. Well, Howard, it looks like pretty soon we could pull up with our cars, say filler up and mean zinc instead of obsolete oil. All thanks to some Israeli ingenuity. This is David W. Bash with the Business Report. Back to you, Howard.
Stay with us, because later in this show, we'll tell you about a new movie about a Jewish boy who became a member of the Hitler Youth. And we'll talk to Abe Foxman, live in the studio. He's the national director of the ADL, the man who is saying that a Supreme Court nominee may be anti-Semitic. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Some fly the airline of Israel simply because we have the most non-stops, the world's best trained pilots, and an unparalleled on-time record. Some fly for other reasons as well.
The Michael Endy Gallery, the gallery for contemporary Israeli art and Judaica. The two floors of the Michael Endy Gallery contain the works of today's most prominent Israeli artists, including Yaakov Agam, Yossel Bergner, Reuven Rubin, Kaddishman, and many more. Also young, up-and-coming Israeli painters and sculptors such as Ofra Friedland, Aharon Bezalel, Nomi Faran, and Richard Shiloh. A collection of the world's finest Judaica crafted by Michael Endy is here in New York at the Michael Endy Gallery, just one block from the Plaza Hotel at 135 West 58th Street between 6th and 7th Avenue. We have space available for private parties, fundraisers, and meetings. Call 212-582-8282, the Michael Endy Gallery.
American Jewish leaders are talking about Supreme Court nominee Judge Clarence Thomas. What they're saying is, you haven't backed away enough from black Muslim leader Louis Farrakhan. Many Jewish groups are insisting that Thomas completely repudiate Farrakhan, not just his anti-Semitic statements. Thomas issued a statement last Friday distancing himself from Farrakhan, but this has not been entirely to the satisfaction of many Jewish leaders. Thomas, in two speeches given in 1983, described Farrakhan as a man I have admired for more than a decade. Henry Siegman, executive director of the American Jewish Congress, has said that if Judge Thomas expressed admiration for Farrakhan, he has disqualified himself for service on the Supreme Court. With us now is Abraham Foxman, executive director of the Anti-Defamation League. Mr. Foxman has been vocal in his criticism of Judge Thomas. Mr. Foxman, my first question is, do you think Judge Thomas is anti-Semitic?
Absolutely not. He's a man of integrity. He's a man with close, warm relationships to the Jewish community. It's not a question of his anti-Semitism. It's really a question of admitting a mistake and distancing himself not only from what Mr. Farrakhan said, but from Mr. Farrakhan.
Why is your organization and others still unsatisfied with his statement of Friday condemning anti-Semitism?
Because, again, we know where the judge stands on anti-Semitism. We respect the fact that he's not an anti-Semite, has never encouraged. It is a question here that a man made a mistake. He lavishly praised Louis Farrakhan. He did so after 8 years that when Louis Farrakhan preached and espoused anti-Semitism. It's very difficult to differentiate between the messenger and the message. What we are waiting and asking the judge to do is to basically disassociate himself from the totality of the hatred, the racism, the bigotry, and the anti-Semitism that Louis Farrakhan represents.
What does Judge Thomas have to say? What language is the Jewish community looking for that would satisfy the community and stop this fracas?
I think far be it from us to write the script. The judge made a mistake by smoking marijuana. He very easily put it behind him. He said, I made a mistake. I believe the judge made a mistake by praising Louis Farrakhan. It's not sufficient to say, I'm not an anti-Semite. Louis Farrakhan is. There is language, sufficient language. The judge is capable and articulate to find a way to say, I reject Louis Farrakhan and what he stands for.
Do you think the Jewish uproar over Judge Thomas will exacerbate tensions between blacks and Jews?
Well, if it continues to be a central issue in the debate, it will, but I doubt it. I think it's a sideshow and it's a side play, and of course there are people interested in making this an issue. We're not, and I don't think Judge Thomas is. And I think in the next few days, hopefully, we'll find a way to put this behind us.
Do you see any other issues that may cause friction on the Jewish agenda?
There may be one, and that's the question of separation of state and church. We're not exactly sure where Judge Thomas stands on the question of parochial aid, prayers in the schools, etc. There are some expressions, but I think we'll have to wait to see how he deals with those issues during the judiciary questioning. But there, too, I think he understands our sensitivities, and hopefully that will not become a major stumbling block.
Thank you, Mr. Foxman, for joining us today. Howard?
Up next, the true story of a young Jewish boy who joins the Nazis. Henry Sapoznik has a review. Stay with us.
Imagine 22,000 English words that trace their source, Shoresh, to Biblical Hebrew. Like the Hebrew word toeva, it's the real source for the word taboo. The word over derives from Hebrew avar. Earth comes from Eretz, organ from Irgun. Learn thousands of English words that stem from Hebrew roots. From Schapalsky Publishers in only $19.95, 20% off retail. Order the word by phone, 212-633-2022.
David's Harp Glatt Kosher Restaurant, the best place in Manhattan for lunch, dinner, business meetings, and special events. Four floors of Chinese food, dairy, and meat. A separate floor for banquets. In David's Harp Restaurant, the food is always fresh and delicious. Reasonable prices and excellent service. Every Saturday night, a special guest performer. So don't wait and come to enjoy our facilities. David's Harp, 150 West 46th Street in Manhattan. For reservations, call 212-768-3333. Free parking from 5 p.m.
This is a true story. A Jewish child survives World War II in Germany by joining the Hitler Youth. There's a new film out about this, and here with a review is Henry Sapoznik. Henry?
About midway through Europa, Europa, a new Franco-German film by director Agnieszka Holland, a young German soldier named Josef Peters is having a conversation with an older actor turned soldier. Is it hard to play someone else, he asks? It's easier than being yourself. These are not just the musings of a stage-struck young boy, for while the older soldier was an actor, Josef Peters is an actor. He is, in reality, Solomon Perl, a Jew. Unlike those who hid from the Nazis in attics and barns, circumstances forced young Solomon Perl, brilliantly played by Marco Hofschneider, to hide in plain sight, which, because of his quick wit, good looks, and ease with languages, found it possible to not be himself. Let's take a look at a clip.
Kennst du das nicht? Habt ihr das nicht an der Ostfront gesungen?
Nein.
Das lernst du noch. Hier lernst du alles.
Schwarz. Schwarz, kümmere dich um Peters. Er ist dein Stubenkamerad. Geh mit ihm zur Uniformausgabe und zeig ihm alles.
Jawohl.
Freut mich.
Beautifully photographed in moody, muted colors, the images we are offered are also multicolored. The occasional Germans who, after learning Perl's real identity, try to shield him, are contrasted with a tryst in a field with a Hitler youth groupie, which turns into a horrifying metaphor for the destruction of European Jewry after they come upon hundreds of Jewish gravestones being rounded up.
Wenn du willst, können wir es tun. Ich möchte es, Jupp, hörst du? Ich möchte es so sehr.
Dafür bist du noch viel zu jung.
Du bist doch blöd. Ich muss jetzt gehen.
Ich bin hier Hause, ja?
Wenn du willst. Du spinnst wirklich, Jupp. Fang mich!
If director Holland does have a fault, it's by indulging herself in far too many suspenseful moments where the young Solomon is in danger of being unmasked and is saved at the last second. Too many of these are not so ay-ay-ay. Europa, Europa, in German with good English subtitles, ends as it starts, with a lone voice singing Hine Ma Tov. But only at the conclusion do we learn that the voice belongs to the older Perl, now living in Israel, whose own brand of resistance was the self-submersion that led to self-survival. Howard?
Henry, I'll tell you, that looks like quite a story. You know, the German and with the English subtitles and all sort of reminds me of Nasty Girl, with that same German self-confessional type of Jewish movie.
Well, there's a whole spectrum of films that have come out in the last couple of years that deal with these kind of reconciliations in terms of the national historical attitude. On a certain level, I guess you can't spell catharsis without the word art.
Henry, that's very interesting.
Where can we catch this film? Where is it playing?
It's currently at the Lincoln Plaza Cinema, which is at 63rd Street and Broadway in Manhattan.
Thanks for the review, Henry. I think we're going to have to see this movie. Looks good. Quite a story. Well, that's our report for tonight. For David, Melody, Henry, and everyone at JNN, I'm Howard Barbanel.
And I'm Nicole Adler. Good night.
Good night, good luck, and shalom.
Shalom. Shalom. Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom. Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom.
Shalom. Shalom. Shalom. Shalom.